All right, I'll make it super fast. Hey, it's me, Destin. Welcome back to Smarter Every Day. When you're in a jet, if the cabin depressurizes, they drop this little mask out of the top. What happens if you're in a depressurized cabin and you're up above 15,000 feet and you drop your mask? Something called hypoxia takes effect, and you got to do something about that. Let's get smarter every day.
You've heard the flight attendant say this before. Secure your own mask before helping others. But why? Why do they say that? Is the 30 seconds it takes to put on a kid's mask next to me really that important? 15 years ago, I learned the answer to this question when I was selected to participate in NASA's Reduced Gravity Student Flight Opportunities Program at NASA's Johnson Space Center. Before I got to ride in the Vomit Comet, I had to undergo physiological training in a hypobaric chamber at the Neutral Buoyancy Lab. Fast forward to now. Today, astronaut Don Pettit is scheduled to renew his hypoxia training certification, and I asked him if it would be okay if I tagged along. He let me swim a few laps with him over the International Space Station mock-up in the Neutral Buoyancy Lab before we headed over next door for Don's training.
You look like something the dog dragged in.
I feel like it too.
The purpose of hypoxia training is to let astronauts and aviators know when their brain is about to stop working correctly, which is very, very important. If you're at a high altitude in an airplane, the air is thinner, but the cabin is pressurized, so your body gets enough oxygen to operate. To simulate cabin depressurization, NASA puts its astronauts in a chamber at sea level and then pumps the air out to thin it out so that it simulates a higher altitude. Don's training starts with classwork, focused on understanding the specific signs and symptoms of hypoxia in his own body. The goal of this training is to understand your own physiological symptoms so that you can take action quickly. For example, Don said he experiences tunnel vision and air hunger, but I remember from my training 15 years ago that I get really happy and start to tingle all over.
I can't take you seriously because this is what you look like.
What do you mean? I look perfectly normal.
This is the experiment we're going to do. Don and I are both going to enter the hyperbaric chamber at the same time and fly up to FL-250, at which point we're going to remove our masks and start to experience the effects of hypoxia. Don is the control. He's a trained astronaut who recognizes the symptoms for hypoxia and immediately corrects for them. I, on the other hand, am under the direct supervision of a NASA flight surgeon, and after I noticed the effects of hypoxia, I've asked if I could delay for about 1 minute so we can better understand the physiological effects of not immediately putting your mask on.
Okay, here we go. We're getting set up.
While Jerry gets me situated, I'm going to talk about the two types of decompression. Number one, rapid decompression. This is like being inside of an explosion. You dump all your pressure instantly, all the moisture condenses out of the air, you're suddenly in a cloud. Very scary, very violent. Yeah, we're not going to do that. What we're going to do is simulate a slow, steady leak. We're going to start at sea level and ascend at 5,000 feet per minute all the way up to 25,000 feet, or as aviators call it, flight level 250.
You can see the altimeter right here above Jerry. He's pointing it out to you. So we're just passing through 10,000 feet of altitude. I want to start talking a little bit about the gas expansion. You'll see the gloves here already are starting to show the effects of the reduced pressure. So Boyle's law obviously is telling us that any time we have in the body, as long as the temperature remains constant, we go to altitude, reduce the pressure, then the gases inside that is going to expand.
I'm experiencing Boyle's law in my gut right now.
I am too. We're passing gas.
All right, gentlemen, we are coming into flight level 250. What Sharon is going to do is she's going to level off at that altitude. She's going to give us a little bit of a vent to get rid of some of that angle of bank that you guys were talking about. Now that we're at 250, what we're going to do is I need you to disconnect your mask from the right-hand side so that both of you get hypoxia at the same time, even with the mask disconnected, if you could do that for me. So if you'll drop your mask from the right-hand side, turn your regulator off. You can look at the surgeon's gloves. You can see that they are really experiencing some gas expansion. How are you guys feeling inside the chamber as far as the gas goes?
Feeling good.
And so we're going to start this hypoxia demonstration. Whoever has the toy, if you want to use that for me. So what I'd like for you to do is to pick up a piece, hold it up, show everybody, and tell me what shape it is.
It's a triangle.
All right, so you're going to put it inside the box? Good.
Okay.
Next piece.
Another triangle.
Another triangle.
Circle.
Circle, no, it's a cylinder.
It's a cylinder.
Cross.
Across.
Square.
Square.
That's another cube.
This is a cylinder.
We also can see a little purple come around your nose and your lip area.
This is a star.
Now, before we do it again, Let's put your pulse ox on your finger. We haven't done that yet. Let's try to check your O2 saturation and see what we're down to. You've been off oxygen now for 2 minutes, by the way.
Roger that.
Don, how you doing over there?
I'm starting to feel like I'm going to black and white and the Looney Tunes kind of thing. My vision is going into just a central spot.
All right, so Don, you can go back on oxygen anytime you want to. You don't have to stay off. I'd like to know what the O2 saturation is on your pulse ox there. What does it read now?
67.
Okay, so that's a critical area here where you need to start thinking about getting back on oxygen, because once you get below 60, death can occur just like that, right? So you got to realize that you don't want to die. Can we try the shape box one more time just to compare a difference between when you were just starting your demonstration versus right now? We can tell you're really starting to feel the effects of hypoxia.
Triangle?
Yeah, what I'm interested in is to see what kind of coordination he has now.
Starting to tingle.
Yeah, you've been off oxygen for about 3 minutes, 45 seconds. What is that?
Square.
And what was that one?
That was a square.
A square. Are you sure that's this one?
All right, starting to have a little shake there, you know, that lack of oxygen. You need to start thinking about getting back on oxygen now, Destin. What would you do if you felt like you needed to get on oxygen? How would you correct for that? Can you correct for hypoxia for me? All right, so if you don't get on oxygen, you're going to die, right? You're not going to be able to survive this. Go to your regulator, get all three switches up on your regulator. All right, go to your regulator, get all three switches on your regulator. All right, let's go ahead and put him on for him. Let's get him back on. All right, let's continue on with the shape box.
So you're going to square?
Yeah, all right, good deal, good deal.
Circle?
Look at that. See, that right there proves how much he's already gone from hypoxia back to feeling 100%.
But this is really important. So this is why on aircraft, they tell you to put your oxygen mask on before you help younger children.
That's exactly correct, yes.
Because you want to be able to have the mental awareness to be able to save yourself and save others.
If you're waiting, what can happen is that while you're trying to reach over and put that oxygen mask on that child, you may end up passing out from the lack of oxygen.
That's super important. I'm probably going to pay attention to the man or woman that's giving me the pre-flight briefing again.
Okay, I want to make one thing abundantly clear. We performed this demonstration at 25,000 feet and had about 3 to 5 minutes of consciousness left. However, most airliners travel at 35,000 feet. Look at this chart. There is way less oxygen up there. At 35,000 feet, you literally have seconds of useful consciousness at that altitude. You can go from a normally rational person to someone so helpless you can't even save yourself if your life depends on it.
I don't want to die.
I don't tell you this to scare you. I simply want you to understand the physiology behind that little pre-flight announcement. Put your mask on first before helping others.
I can tell you right now, had Susan not been in there with you and gotten your mask back on, we say it, you would have died. You really would have.
Thank you for saving my life, Susan. Oh, your hamburger.
Copy.
Look, I don't want to get too deep or philosophical with this, but I think there's a neat metaphor here. Sometimes it's easy for me to see the problems in other people and focus on that, and I get so carried away with fixing other people that I forget that I have a problem too. And I think that's what's so cool about this demonstration. Sometimes you just gotta put your mask on first and get yourself sorted before you can help others.
So thanks again for saving my life,
You're
by the way.
You're welcome. It was an honor and a pleasure.
That was great.
I'll save you all the time.
Thank you.
There you go. Now we learn why you need to put your mask on first before you help other people. You don't want to get hypoxia. I'm Destin. You're getting smarter every day. Have a good one.
If you feel like this video earned your subscription, feel free to click this box that I'm in right now, or you can click to support on Patreon and you'll be notified via email every time I release a video. I want to say thank you to the awesome people at NASA's Neutral Buoyancy Laboratory. They kept me super safe, super informed, and they educated me and made me smarter every moment I was with them. That was really awesome. Thank you so much, guys.
Anyway, I'm Destin. You're getting smarter every day. Have a good one.
What's the deal here, Don?
Well, I cut the regular lens off of the goggles.
Okay.
And then I took an old pair of glasses and I cut the plastic to fit my goggles and then I glued them on.
You basically MacGyvered your own goggles so that you had correction underwater.
That's right.
That's pretty good.